Today we're going to talk about corporate Christmas peer-to-peer fundraising. And it's going to be, well, mainly just corporate peer-to-peer fundraising. And we'll see later why it's so relevant to add the Christmas part to that headline later. I have one main thing that I really want to tell today, and that is that you see a company peer-to-peer fundraiser as one key way you can increase the value to the company, your company supporters from their donations. And I'll get back to this. And this is really the key message today. So I wanted to start with that. Yes. Okay, great. And so over the next 10 to 15 minutes, we will be going through three different parts. First, we're going to look at data. We're going to look at how much companies fundraise, for who they fundraise, and when companies fundraise. We're going to look at a few examples. I'm going to come with some of the advice that we have from the experience and learnings we have picked up over the years. And the end, it's going to be the more tangible part where you hopefully get some actionable things to go home and start doing today to get started on corporate peer-to-peer fundraising. Great. So let's just get started. This is how much a corporate peer-to-peer fundraisers on average fundraise these 671 euros. That is around 50% more than the average peer-to-peer fundraiser. So a company fundraises more than an individual. They have roughly the same distribution. We can see the median amount is 62 euros. So basically what this tells us is that a few company fundraisers will fundraise the vast majority. So that also means that if you have a small, like a low number of corporate fundraisers each year, you might have one year that's just going to have an amazing result because you have that one fundraiser that fundraises 5,000 euros, 10,000 euros, 30,000 euros. And if you only have 10 fundraisers, well, you might not have it the next year because you only have 10 fundraisers. And the distribution is extremely skewed. So it's both worth of caution and worth noticing. So to which type of courses do companies in general fundraise from, right? And as you can see from this graph, it follows the distributions of where normal peer-to-peer fundraising happens. There's not like big differences. So of course, this graph is incredible bias towards which customers better now have. And we have a lot of health charities as our customers because it is a really great fit for them to do peer-to-peer fundraising. So not necessarily true that this is how it would be in the total overall general population. There's two things that stick out. And that is children and youth charities seem to have fewer corporate fundraisers. Anecdotal, I cannot make that fit with my perceived reality. We at least know that quite a few children's and youth charities have great success with company fundraising. On the other hand, that emergency aid is quite popular with charities, with companies is no surprise. And this comes from especially when a catastrophe happens, earthquakes, tsunamis, those kind of things, companies tend to rally around emergency aid charities. So that's no surprise, but besides that, there's no big difference compared to where individuals fundraise. Okay, when do companies fundraise, right? So here it's an index graph. So index 100 is the monthly average. And as you can see, November, December is definitely where the companies fundraise. Actually, more than 50% of all company fundraisers, or at least 50% of all donations, happen in November and December. And it's also a decent amount of the overall peer-to-peer fundraising landscape, as just above 5% of all donations that go to P2P fundraising happens to company fundraisers in November and December. So definitely worth taking into account when you're planning your P2P fundraising strategy, right? Okay, now, why do companies fundraise? They fundraise to a large extent for the same reasons individuals fundraise. We have, but not completely, right? So we usually say that at least some individuals fundraise because based on that they love you as an organization, they care deeply about the cause, and that could also be the case for the companies, and at least that's what we see. Companies fundraise based on, if not necessarily the company's convictions, then definitely based on the employees' convictions. This is also where the whole part of emergency fundraising fits in. When there's current social issues, catastrophes, whether it's being an earthquake in Japan or it is Black Lives Matter, employees are outraged or feel have emotions, have anger, and they will want to fundraise, and they take that with them into their workplace. We also have a few companies who fundraise based on sales and marketing goals. That is it's basically only the very, very small companies, often one-man shows. It's consultants, individuals, freelancers, small agencies, and they're doing whatever they can to get a new customer in, and sometimes they think doing a fundraiser for charity might help them. It rarely does. So we usually say that that's not the main thing to go out and tell companies, right? What you can go out and tell companies, it will help them engage the employees. And it will help them engage the employees in their mission statement, in their values, in their CSR policies. And this is also where we see, and this is often something that happens around Christmas. This is holiday spirit. Often also there's a lot of social activities going on and during that period. And social activities are often quite fitting with fundraising activities. And I'll go through a few company fundraisers. And the first one is, I would say this is probably best practice on a company fundraiser. So this is Knowit. It's a digital UX design agency. They fundraise, at least for the last 3 years, they've been fundraising for UNHCR, Sweden for UNHCR. They are basically doing all the things they should be doing, right? They have leadership buy-in. They have the CEO as the face of this fundraiser. They are not only doubling, they are tripling the donations. They are all in on the communication, persistent internal communication. And they have conviction behind what they're doing. They have reason for what they're doing. All in all, it makes for a great fundraiser with a great result. And in general, these double or triple donation campaigns, they are as good as they get. Employees have a great incentive for donating. And often these happen with companies that have a lot of white label employees. So like this company, and here's another example with Bambua, a financial payment provider. Often employees are quite well off, and they also really great later donor leads. Here we have another example. It's a different variation, not as interesting for most of you as the employees pick an organization. So it is often a more fleeting relationship you get. It's a 1 year thing most often, but nonetheless, valuable donations, and you get you're being put in front of some really interesting donors. Make sure the only thing you can do here is really to try to lobby to be on the vote, right? This is often something that happens with foreign companies, Scandinavian offices. Though we have also seen, for example, the Danish auditor chain BDO have also been doing this for several years. And there it is actually something that might be worth lobbying to be on the vote, to be picked as charity of the year. Yes. Great. So a little bit of advice from what we have been seeing from some of these campaigns, right? As we already mentioned, leadership buy-in is crucial for it being successful. The face needs to be the CEO, not the marketing director or anyone else. It needs to be the CEO, maybe the chairman of the board in a few rare cases. You will need to also set expectations with the company that you will follow up on these donations, right? These are very valuable donor leads. As long as you don't send them to aggressive telemarketing agents, it should probably be okay to send them a follow-up newsletter with, this is where we are using your money. And even an ask for a membership. Then we have timing. Timing your contact to corporates is like makes for higher chance of success, right? Christmas, the obvious one to go for. And then of course, whenever there's emergencies, current affairs. And then we have one that's probably a bit overlooked, and that is any type of gifting occasion. And it's just completely like a birthday fundraiser, a wedding fundraiser for individuals. The same thing happens for fundraisers. They have company anniversaries. The CEO have been there for 10 years, 20 years. Often cases where there's a lot of wine gifts. And well, I think we should try to get more of those wine gifts to become donations too, right? So if possible, and if you have this type of information in your CRM system, it's quite valuable. Try to go after them and at least put it out as a possibility. The fourth is many of these examples I just shown were double, triple donations. Another approach you definitely can take, especially up here to Christmas, where it's just around the corner and there's not that much time. So go out and make it an offer. Not an ask, right? Go out and say, hey, you have already made X amount of donations over the last year. Let's visualize this donation to let you get the most value out of it. Visualize it on a fundraising page. Your task is to go out and coach your employees to donate. Make it some kind of engaging experience together with the HR department. And suddenly the company have gotten way more value out of that. The donation they already made, you got a ton of donor leads and hopefully the double amount of in donations. And so in a more tangible way, this is how you would go about do that. List your existing corporate supporters in your CRM. Fill out those small companies. And call your corporate partners. Offer to showcase donations made throughout the year. Help with the equation and make sure to get leadership buy-in. But that's the basic and set of instructions. And it's gonna be it's basically picking up the phone and calling your corporate supporters to have this happen. Yes. And that also means we are actually at the end of the webinar. I like these short webinars. I also hope you do. And if you do, then I would strongly encourage you to also sign up to our newsletter. And if you want to be signed up to the newsletter, well, just answer yes in this poll and I'll make sure you're signed up for our newsletter. And it's out once a month and includes, for example, invitations for webinars and new blog posts and ton of other stuff.